Matt Starr here. I just wanted to take a minute to explain why I made this video. There are already a lot of really great cover versions of Rosanna on YouTube, so this is definitely not intended to be that. This is also not intended to be an instructional video on how to play the main beat, the main halftime shuffle beat. For that, you can also go on YouTube and just look up Jeff instructing on how to do that himself on his own video from the late 80s. What I did want to do with this video was a couple of things. I wanted to break down how I think the song was probably recorded in terms of microphones, and I also wanted to fill in some of the playing details that have to do with some of the fills and some of the other things that maybe don't get talked about too much that actually can help you to play the song a little more authentically. I also wanted to shout out to the two people most responsible for the sound of this song other than Jeff himself, which would be the original tracking engineer, the great Al Schmidt, and the original mixing engineer, the late, great Greg Ladany. I hope you enjoy the video. Please feel free to leave comments and questions, and enjoy. Thanks. One of the things that I made sure I paid attention to with this song was getting some of the instruments that were, to my knowledge, the same thing that he used on this recording. So here we have Gretsch Jasper shells in sizes 10 by 8, 12 by 8, 13 by 9, and 16 by 14 in my case. I think his was a 16 by 16. But the Gretsch Jasper shell thing is a very big part of his sound. And this bass drum here also is the same thing. It's a 14 by 22. You'll see the front head is completely cut out, which was something that he did. And inside there we have a packing blanket right up against the head and a sandbag that holds that packing blanket in place, which is another big part of the sound. The snare drum sound, which is actually another super important part of what makes this song sound the way that it does. This drum here, let me pull it up for 2 seconds so you can see it, is a approximately 1940s era Slingerland Radio King, which means it's a solid shell. I have a coated Remo control sound, and I have a Remo ring, and I have a couple of extra pieces of tape just because I felt that the drum was still ringing a little too much. I wanted it to have a certain tone to it that I heard, and if you go into YouTube right now and you type in Toto Rosanna demo, you will come up with a video that is audio of what I have heard is the center channel of the 5.1 mix, which means that certain things are in that channel and nothing else. In this case, the drums are there, the bass is there, but what's super cool is the drums are not reverbed and delayed out like they are on the final recording. So what you hear is the dry sound of the drums, and that actually helped me a lot in figuring out how to get this sound. Because as soon as I matched my sound in here, in my smaller room, with the dry sound on that, adding the reverb was easier. It made more sense because I knew what it actually sounded like without it. It's very hard to tell what drum tones sound like when there's a lot of reverb and delays on them. I should also mention that on my toms, I have Remo Clear Emperors all the way around, which is probably what Jeff was using, but he also could have been using a coated Ambassador. But the other key to this sound is I'm using these Roots EQ mutes. And my cymbals are not what Jeff would have used because Jeff was a peisty guy. And my understanding was the record Toto 4 was made with a bunch of peisty either 602s or 2002s. But what I used is Zildjian. I have some Avidus cymbals, two crashes, a 19 and a 20. I have an 18-inch, a custom crash here, an Avidus ride, which is a 21-inch ride, and then these A Master Sound hi-hats. I did my best to match even cymbal pitches, weights, as best I could, approximating it by listening. Next thing to talk about is the groove from the beginning. If you'll notice when I play it, there's fewer ghost notes than what it ends up being. It ends up being a pretty busy part, but this first section is actually pretty sparse. Another important part of the sound, just to discuss this really briefly, you will have seen me play the groove a minute ago. I don't think there was ever any video of my right foot, but Jeff was was known for sure, and you can see it on his video, and he talked about it, to play into the head, meaning bury the beater into the head, which has a certain sound, and it is with an emphasis on attack. It kind of shortens the note or the length of the note, combined with the fact that we have this bass drum that has the hole in the front and the packing blanket and the sandbag pushed right up against it. Those things all kind of go together to play into the head and have the bass drum set up that way, so you get a very smacky sounding. It's hard for me to demonstrate what it would be like to play out of the head, because at this point, the way the drum's set up, it wouldn't make much of a difference, but we all know what that sounds like. It's a rounder note. It's a little longer, depending on how you have the drum set up. It can be really long. But Jeff had a very specific style, and he liked to play that way. Also, speaking of sonic considerations, I experimented with playing the main groove with and without rim shots, and I did discover that while the drum sounded a little fatter without rim shots, it wasn't the right sound. It didn't sit in the track properly. So I'm pretty sure, again, from listening to that dry demo, that he played with a rim shot. As opposed to microphones, just a real simple rundown here. On the hi-hat, I'm using a Biodynamic M160, which is a ribbon mic. This is a Biodynamic M201 dynamic mic, which I sometimes use on snare, but works great on this high tom. 12 and 13 have Sennheiser MD421s. The floor tom has a Biodynamic M88, and the snare has a AKG 451. My understanding is that was what was used on this recording. And when I experimented with the 57 on top, it didn't sound as correct as the 451. So the 57 I have is on the bottom. And in the kick drum, I used an AKG D12, which is a vintage mic. And my overheads are Cole's 4038s, which is definitely not what they would have used. With a little bit of EQ, these are fantastic sounding overhead mics. They're ribbons, so they're not gonna sound like condensers, which is what was used on this song originally. But I was able to get it pretty close. I did set up a room mic, but in the end, I didn't use it. It was recorded in Sunset Sound in room 2, which would probably have a little more life than what I'm hearing on this YouTube thing. So I'm thinking that Jeff might have been in one of the smaller booths at Sunset 2, or he was in the main room, but they baffled him off. So it's hard to say for sure, but it sounds pretty dry to me. The opening fill is a really cool way to play something that like 99.9% of people would play differently. It's a triplet starting on beat 4. It is 2 snare drum notes and a rack tom. So most people would play right, left, right, crash. But what Jeff does, if you watch his video, which is out there, it's on YouTube, you can buy it on DVD, etc., which you should do, is actually, he plays left, left, right, right. He goes 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 1. What it is it gives you a certain dynamic shape. This is up sounding very even and stiff. This kind of just like sneaks that in there, and it's all over the song. Every time he plays a fill, the transitions that isn't the long fill, he does that. He plays a sticking here, and the sticking is what's cool about that is that there's an inner dynamic to it, just like that opening fill. There's an inner dynamic to it because you've got a sticking, a double stroke followed by a single stroke. So you have this inner dynamic, an easy way to play an accent. Sometimes he plays a triplet partial on the high tom before that. Okay, so that's another part of that fill as well. Let's talk about the transitional fill that includes this fill we've already heard a bunch of times that goes into the chorus and then proceeds into the double chorus at the end. right, right, left, right. Just kind of like a four-stroke rough. One, two, three, four.